Alright, welcome back to my Dark Souls 1, Soul Level 1 guided walkthrough using the Remastered Edition. And we made it to Anolondo, and here the difficulty will increase a bit. And not counting the DLC, there are two specific places that will give the greatest challenge in this playthrough. Namely the fight against ONS and the fight against the Four Kings. But I can at least provide you with a pretty effective strategy against both of these bosses. And in case of Ornstein and Smough, don't get nervous, but we are going to use the Red Tearstone Ring. And that may sound... Oh, holy fuck, what am I doing? Whoops, I barely saved myself with a save quit. Yeah, remember when I said that you can even do that in mid-air, if you're fast enough? Well, let's pretend that I just did that on purpose to demonstrate how to do that. Anyway, as I was saying, using the Red Tearstone Ring against Ornstein and Smough may sound daunting, because that means getting through the entire fight without taking a single hit. But it will likely give you an easier time that way than with a low damage output, but with the ability to perhaps take a hit depending on the attack, of course. Regardless, it can still be very tough. That fight is a bit RNG heavy because ONS are two separate AIs doing their own thing. And they really complement each other as well. So, well, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. Let's first get there in the first place. Okay, this is dangerous, as you all know. It's best not to lock on, because if the enemies move and you attack, you can move along with them and you can accidentally throw yourself off that way. So just let the enemies come to you and be reactionary. So don't be the first one to attack, just counterattack. You might take an accidental hit, but that you can survive. Dropping down, you cannot survive, obviously. And as you know, the AI is not all that great in Souls games. So if you stand in the right places, the enemies can in fact just jump off, trying to get to you. Alright, time for the infamous Anolondo Archers. This is one of those sections that everyone talks about how miserable it was on their first playthrough. But in fact, in my opinion, it's not the archers themselves that are the problem. By which I mean when you are only facing the two. It's more about the part with the demons right before that, where the archers can already hit you, while you also have to avoid the demons that can shoot you in the back or knock you off the ledge. It is simply a bit RNG heavy. Because as you will see, I am not going to get shot in the back, but that's merely me getting lucky. So my advice is to listen, because you can hear it when the demons fire the projectiles, So you can roll through those projectiles even when you can't see them coming, because they are coming from the back. So basically by waiting a split second to roll after you hear the sound of the demon firing. Now when it comes to the archers themselves, remember that they are shooting arrows, not homing missiles. If you keep moving, their arrows will always hit behind you. So wait behind the obstacle and then start running right after they have fired their arrows. And then when you move towards the one on the right, chances are you already don't have to worry about the one on the left anymore. Roll through the arrow and move into the corner so you can't get knocked off and you have the opportunity to bait a parry. And that's basically all there is to it. You can still hear the other archer firing, but there's no danger anymore of getting hit. Alright, now before we're going to face Ornstein and Smough, there are two things we need to do first. Get Havel's armor and the occult club, and I'll explain in a minute why we're going to need those. And then we're going to visit the giant blacksmith to upgrade our reinforced club all the way to the maximum upgrade level of the lightning path. And then we are actually going to kill him, sad as it may be, to acquire the giant blacksmith hammer. Don't forget that the chest containing the occult club is a mimic. So, the reason we need that weapon is to downgrade it to a divine weapon. You know, occult is a possible upgrade for a divine weapon. And there's one place we're going to need it, namely to kill the three skeletons in the boss arena where we fight against Nido. Because without a divine weapon, those skeletons will resurrect and that will make them a complete pain in the dick. And Havel's armor we also going to wear in that fight, although it's not really necessary in that fight per se. But it is going to be extremely helpful against the four kings. Although the Havel strategy is not all that effective on SL1, and it's absolutely useless on New Game Plus, so at least keep that in mind. But on New Game it can help you out a bit. In case you don't know, there is an unintended shortcut here on the stairs. If you jump at the right location, you can skip a pretty big part, giving you immediate access to ONS and the giant blacksmith. Alright, so now let's fully upgrade a lightning reinforced club and then revert the occult club into a divine weapon. And if you don't have enough twinkling titanite yet, you can buy them now. Make sure you have everything you need, because once you kill an NPC, there is no way back. By the way, if you haven't got enough regular titanite jugs yet, there is one more outside here past the demons on the terrace. And once the giant blacksmith is dead, just homeward bone back and then you can upgrade the hammer at the bonfire.
Thank you.
Okay then, time to take on Ornstein and Smo, which in the main game at least, on SL1, is going to be the hardest part of the playthrough, with the exception, I think, of the four kings. At least in my opinion. But both are pretty tough. Now, my strategy here is to use the red tearstone ring, but I was being a bit of an idiot, and I forgot to actually take the intentional damage necessary to get in red tearstone range. So you will see me enter the boss arena in a minute, and as soon as I hit Ornstein, I suddenly realized that I messed up. Yeah, that's not the amount of damage I want to do. So let's get out of here and try again. So use that Silver Knight to get into Red Tearstone range, and then let's try to do it for real this time. Now, as I've said before, it may be daunting to have to fight against ONS without taking a single hit, and it is, but as you will see, this is definitely easier than without RTSR. Because you will see how fast I can take down Ornstein this way. Moreover, when two-handing the reinforced club, two hits will stagger Ornstein. So using that, I almost take him out before Smo even has the time to get near. Now, RNG does unfortunately play a part here. But very often, Ornstein will start a fight by dashing towards you, and that's exactly what you want. Because you can literally dodge that attack by walking to the side. You don't even have to roll per se. And that gives you the opportunity to immediately get massive damage in. Now, Ornstein is a bit of a dancer, unfortunately, and your weapon is rather slow, so he can quite easily still dodge you when you are right next to him. And then it's all about spacing, waiting for the right opportunity to strike. Remember that the R2 attack is a jump attack, giving you the ability to cover quite a bit of distance. Now, be careful that you don't kill Ornstein at the back of the room, because that's where Smo will spawn for the second phase. And you don't want to start off right next to him. The reason to kill Ornstein first is because there's a very easy way to take down the super version of Smo. 90% of the time when Smo is not already in an attack animation, when you run towards him, he will do a jump attack, meaning that he will go over you, providing the perfect opportunity to counterattack. When he does his lightning attack, rolling back twice is already enough to get out of the area of effect. Now the only thing to be careful of is that there is a small chance that he will either do his charge attack or a sideways hammer attack when you run towards him. In the former case, run away from him, and in the latter case, dodge to his right side. And that's basically all there is to it. It may look and sound easy, but it's all in the execution, and unfortunately also a matter of RNG, to an extent at least. What the hell? What the fuck? What happened? I died for no reason. The boss is already dead, the fork wall is still up, and literally nothing hit me. Well, isn't that nice? I think I've heard of this glitch before, but I thought it was only on PC. So basically it has something to do with one of the hitboxes of Smo's hammer remaining active indefinitely after he attacked. So I suppose that the remastered version suffers from this glitch as well. Well, isn't that nice?
Thou hast journeyed far and overcome much, chosen undead. Come hither, child. O chosen undead, I am Guinevere, daughter of Lord Gwyn and Queen of Sunlight, since the day Father his form did obscureth, I have awaited thee. I bequeath the Lord vessel to thee. And beseech thee, thou shalt...
Okay, so now we have the Lord Vessel, and our first destination is going to be Izalith. And the reason for that is because that's where the last red titanite chunks and red titanite slab can be found. So that means that when we return from Izalith, we will be done upgrading. And fire is more effective against Sif, the Four Kings, and Nito than lightning is. So therefore it's best to do Izalith first. Alright, so the next boss will be Demon Fire Sage. Now, I actually shouldn't have gone human again, because that will cause Kirk to invade, meaning that the bonfire is going to be unavailable. So I was basically like, well, fuck it, let's just continue on to the boss. So, Demon Fire Sage is basically nothing more than the stray demon put in an arena where you have less room to move around in. The reason I equipped the Crest Shield is because his explosions are actually not fire damage, it's actually magic damage. And sometimes, depending on where he is in the room, there may actually be no way to avoid the explosion. So in that case, you can avoid getting killed by turning your back towards the boss and block the incoming explosion. This fight is basically not that hard, because his moveset is literally the same as the Stray Demon. However, the biggest problem is his first attack, because he can immediately start off with an explosion, or he will do an overhead attack with his catalyst. If he does the latter, you have to roll much later than you would expect. Because if you are too early, he will essentially home in on you somehow. It's a bit weird. Other than that, it's all about being careful of the explosions. Especially if the boss jumps into a corner, meaning that you cannot get behind him. And you can only block the explosions if you have your back towards the boss, because the explosions will come from behind. And of course, try to be aggressive in order to get the bleed effect to activate. Okay then, as you know, there is immediately another boss fight up ahead, namely the Centipede Demon. This boss can be quite annoying, because it's a rather RNG heavy fight, and by that I mean the RNG related to him getting near you. Because if he chooses to remain at a distance, there's literally nothing you can do. Well, technically there is, you can cut off his arm, which automatically gives you the orange shard ring, and you can then do a save quit and re-enter the boss arena with the ring already equipped, so you can actually fight him in the lava. But fortunately I didn't have that bad RNG in this fight. But case in point is that he needs to get near you in order for you to be able to fight him in the first place. But once he does, he's not all that difficult. Another thing you can do is to equip some fire resistant clothing and perhaps the fire resistance ring, and then get all the way over to the right side of the arena where there is more room to fight him. On SL1 you will definitely need fire resistance to even be able to get there in the first place. Anyway, just dodge all of his attacks until he finally gets close. And the move you want him to do is his spinning jump attack, because that automatically positions him closer to you. And once he is close enough for you to attack him, there's actually not all that much that he can do. He will mainly jump up, meaning that you need to get out of the way. And it's best to hold your shield up, given the small chance that he will actually throw an explosive projectile down. One more thing he can do is a grab attack where he's trying to eat you. But here's the weird thing, and you will see it happening. If you just mash buttons when you are between his teeth, you will receive no damage. And you are even immune to damage for a short while, because he threw me in the lava. And I managed to get back out without receiving any damage, even though he threw me right into the lava. I have no idea why that is, but somehow that's just the way it is. Now, if you manage to cut off his arm, remember that it actually becomes a separate enemy then, so make sure to quickly kill it. And the final thing to keep in mind is that the boss can in fact bleed, but it's likely that you won't hit him enough times in a row to actually activate the bleed effect. And like most boss fights, it's in the end a matter of patience. Well, the reason I stepped into the lava was to show that I'm not somehow cheating when he dropped me into the lava before. I definitely do take damage. Alright, speaking of lava, now we have the ring, we are able to actually walk through it. Wait a minute, that's not how I remember it. I know I'm SL1, but that's a lot of lava damage when wearing the Orange Shard ring. Huh, that doesn't seem right. Okay, this really doesn't look right. I shouldn't be taking this much damage. So what on earth is going on here? Okay, now I'm getting worried. In the PS3 version, I've never had any problem walking through the lava. I'm pretty damn sure that something is wrong in this version. Seriously, what the fuck? Look at this damage. I mean, come on, this way I have to constantly stop to heal to get through it. What the hell? Are you kidding me? Oh, this is some fucking shit here. Okay, this cannot be right. I never had to slow down this much because I had to heal all the time. So this is clearly a problem with the remastered edition. And I think I know what the problem is actually. This version is 60 frames per second and the original is 30 frames per second. So I think what is happening here is that the extra frames translate to extra lava damage, because it's probably based on how many frames you are in the lava. Well, that is pretty fucking retarded. So I guess that nobody even tested this part of the game. Well, then it looks like we discovered a change from the original, but it's certainly not a positive one. Seriously, I'm not going crazy, am I? Can anyone confirm this? Because this doesn't seem right to me. And this is not how I remember it. Okay, well, at least we made it to the hidden bonfire, even though I had to use all my assets to even get here. And the worst thing is, yeah, the next boss is the fucking bed of bullshit. So, next episode will start off with lots of fun. So, please leave a like, subscribe if you haven't, and stay tuned for a lot of misery in episode 5.